بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام.
So we will continue our بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We'll continue to our discussion of Surah Al-Baqarah. And last time we started discussing the verses that addressed the children of Israel. And we said that the Jews at the time when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam moved to Medina, they constituted significant proportion, if you like, of the demography of that city. Okay, and it makes lot of sense to see Quran addressing that particular group, and especially that they are familiar, or the most people who are familiar with the idea of revelation, because Quran is revelation, but it is not like the first revelation. In fact, it is really the last revelation. So the people of the book were, in particular, the Jews who were very familiar with, because they have received the Torah, they have seen not only Musa alayhi salam, but also those who came before him, okay, up to Ibrahim alayhi salam, and also all the prophets who came after Musa alayhi salam, and they were supposed to follow the Torah and extract from it at each generation, at each time, okay, what would be appropriate to implement in their own lives based on the new challenges that they were really receiving. The same way today we are saying, okay, Quran was revealed 400 years ago, okay, but it doesn't mean that we have to repeat. There is no way to repeat really the dynamics of the societies at 1400 years ago and replicate them today. Each society, each community, each generation has its own challenges and the questions, and they have to resort to the reference of meaning, which is the revelation, to help them, to enlighten them, how they have really to respond to these really challenges and to bring new answers to the new questions that they are really raising. So it is a continuous interrogation with the reference of meaning or direction to give meaning to our own really actions. Okay? And Quran from in Surah Al-Baqarah in particular, this is how it started. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. This is really the book that has the guidance. The guidance. Later on we will see in the same surah, قُلْ إِنَّ هُدَى اللَّهِ هُوَ الْهُدَى. The guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the guidance. It's not a guidance. It's the highest level of guidance. So this is where we have, the same way if I want to know how to move in my life, I need a reference to validate for me that something, that an idea that comes to my mind, that it works in reality. So I put it, for testing, and I test it in the universe, in reality, in this observable reality. If the universe endorse it to me, it works. if it does not endorse it to me, I don't say, oh, the universe is wrong and I am right. I have to revisit and refine my question in order really to make my action compatible with the universe. The universe agrees with it. And we gave several examples, okay? We said, like, if Dr. Shahid came up, like, with a new medication, it looks fine on paper, okay? But nobody will accept to use this medication unless they see what we call clinical trials. Is that right, Dr. Shahid? I mean, you have, what does that really mean? You are testing that drug in the largest laboratory. You tested it in this, your small lab, is that right? Or you tested it on your animals. But now you wanted really like to see if it really works on humans, so it is really a larger. So you go from one level to another, but in every way you are asking the universe to tell you if this really works or not. So, and if the clinical trials showed that the medicine is causing harm to the patients or may kill patients or something like that, does the FDA approve it for you? No, it will not. Even after they approve certain medications and they see that they are not causing benefit or on the contrary causing harm, what do? They withdraw the medication from the market. Is that right? Why? Because the reality, the observable reality, did not agree with your suggestion or with your idea. So it is not anymore speculative thinking. Okay? But we have transcended as humans. And basically, over the last 500 years, we have been enjoying all these discoveries because we have transcended the speculative thinking. And we are following what we call the scientific methodology. What does it really mean, scientific methodology? Every time you come up with a new idea, you tested it in the observable reality, in the universe. If the universe agrees with it, we say it works. So we know that we can move. But the universe does not tell me in what direction I have to move. I make a monopoly on that medication, for example. Okay? And start really exploiting the patients in order to make, let us say, more gain and more money or more wealth of that. Or I say, oh no, I have to be an advocate for the patient, for the poor, okay? And so these are two different directions. Here the revelation helps. You see, you need the revelation to give you the direction of your action. Something that works doesn't mean that it is good all the time. It depends on the direction that you give to this action. Now, especially the new generation, now you have a skill. Don't take it just a knowledge. What I am trying to teach and to preach is a skill. You don't have to, every time you want to do something, to call your dad or to call your imam or to call your friend. Now you have the skill to tell you, okay, this works, but is the direction that I'm giving to this action right? Many times people come to me and say, Brother Wareeb, I am thinking about this project. And they explain to me what is this project. I will not give them an answer. I ask them a question. Does this please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then they will say, I got the answer. Salaamu alaykum. I got the answer because they know that is this action that you are going to take, is it helping the people, benefiting the people, or you may be causing harm? Okay, I want to open a restaurant. Is there any problem about opening a restaurant? No problem. But if I start really advocating like and asking people like to or like allowing people like to smoke Hubble Bubble and hookah and I don't know what, or drink alcohol or something, now I am not really helping the people. I'm not benefiting the people. I may be causing harm, or a reason to cause harm. You see, believe me, you don't have to tell them this is halal, this is haram. Give them the skill because they can apply it. It's like one of my professors in organic chemistry used to tell us, I will teach you one equation. If you understand it, then you can apply the concept to hundreds of equations. And people in the audience know how difficult to teach and learn organic chemistry. But really that helped us a lot, meaning that you need to learn a skill rather than memorizing an equation. Next probably hour you will forget it. But if you understand the concept behind it, you can apply that concept to hundreds of equations. So, and we have heard, me and also Brother Naji, and the discussion that we had over all these years, how important it is to see the revelation as the reference for meaning, for as a reference for direction. And this is how Quran approached and addressed the children of Israel, saying that you, what you have received, okay, is not the end. You need to continue the journey. And you are invited to join the new group of believers that Quran called them al-muttaqin from the beginning of the surah. And I want you to join that fold. And these verses that you are listening to, do not be the first to cover up their truth. وَلَا تَكُونُوا أَوَّلَ كَافِرٍ بِهِ. What is kafir? Kufr, okay, which is denial of the truth, is really stopping the journey. It's like reaching a closed and like road. There is no exit from
dead end.
Believe me, dead. You see the word dead? قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَ. قُتِلَ, killed. That, أَكْفَرَ. The worst thing, the worst disease that can inflict the human beings is the disease of kufr, the disease of covering up the truth. So continue the journey. And this is a new time, new epoch. Okay? And this is the period of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, endorsing, musaddiqan, endorsing what you have received, but now bringing the revelation itself into a higher level of understanding, into a higher horizon, overarching. Overarching is not dominating. Overarching is like including what has been revealed before. This is the endorsement. You have endorsed it, but you brought it now into the next level. Why? Because this is a different time, different challenges. And instead of being an obstacle, we want you to be part of the solution. This is the address to them. Not saying that you are bad or you are not good because you have this or that. No, 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 this is not the argument. You don't see any argument in the verses telling them that your Torah is distorted or changed or something. No, no, that's not the issue. The issue is now it is a different time. You need, and this is huge. If in the project of prophecy we see that revelation itself was subject to change, why are we becoming an obstacle to change? If the revelation is the highest thing that we revere as people of faith, as we refer sometimes to ourselves, okay, along with others, Christians and Jews, and okay, why are we stopping the journey of going forward? And this is how we need to approach Quran. You need to read it differently. Each generation should read it differently. In order to do that, you need more sciences. Do you think that understanding what was going in Medina was simple? And it was really a simple society. You need to understand it. It's a structure, it's dynamics, realities, what are the prevalent ideas, what make people laugh, what make them sad, what are their concerns, what are their challenges, okay? What are their hopes, their aspirations? Without understanding all this, how am I going to make a change in that society? Otherwise, my message will be like in this concordance with the reality itself. While the success of a prophecy has been all the time is that the prophets and messengers speak always the language of their society. And there is no language without idea. Remember that. Language has no meaning if it's not really expressing idea. There is no language without idea. Because we think, because we have ideas, we need a language to express that thinking, which other creatures lack. They don't. We are the only living creatures that are capable of dissociating ourselves from ourselves and from our actions. We say, I'm talking to myself. What does it mean? You've separated yourself from yourself, so you are really conscious about your inner self. And you can separate your action and say, okay, is my action? You can reflect on your action. This is what Quran exactly describes, بَلِ الْإِنسَانُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ بَصِيرًا. The human being has insight into his or her own self. So every one of us knows, no matter how many excuses we give to others, we know ourselves if we are really doing something right or wrong. This is exactly what the verse is saying. بل الإنسان على نفسه بصيرة. So بصر is vision, sight. But بصيرة is inside. You are looking into yourself. The animals cannot do that. They and their actions are one. They cannot separate themselves from their actions. We can separate our actions from ourselves, and we have the capacity to reflect really on them. And with this, let us see the next verse. وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. So, أَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ, pray, is that right? Prayer. So the Jews were not praying. Yes, they have a prayer. They have a prayer. But now even the shape of the prayer changed. The form of the prayer changed to be compatible with the new message. If you remember, we were saying the prayer of the Jews, how do they pray? What is the salient feature? Yes, like this. Being reminded every time to stand up straight because they are facing oppression, the bondage of slavery. So the form of the prayer was reminding them all the time how to stand up and regain their humanity, their autonomy. Why? They are facing now a new Qibla. They are not facing the master, but the master of all masters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now they have a different address. But with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is not only standing up, which is still there. It has been included and endorsed in our prayer, because standing up straight is still part of our, of Muhammad's prayer sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But you see at the end of the verse, it says, وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. There is another state in the prayer that is added, which is ruku', which was not there. Bowing down.
Dr. Carr, what verse are you on?
Number 43. وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. Now, before to get into how the ruku' fits into the model of prayer, let us see the phrase before it. وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ. Remember at the beginning of the surah, Quran was talking about المتقين وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. Because the challenge was to face the underground movement of Nifaq. So they have to use also their wealth and resources and time and effort to stand up for this very dangerous movement that intends to destroy the society from within. In Mecca, the believers were asked to pay and to spend and to offer and to share in order to elevate themselves. Zakah. يُؤْتِي مَالَهُ يَتَزَكَّى. You see? So the idea of sharing was really like to be transformed and move from one self to another. Here, for the Jews, they are really asked to transform themselves. Now you are moving into a new era. You have to transform yourself. إِرْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ is not just an additional, haphazard, additional movement in the prayer. But remember how Quran introduced to us al-ruku'. You remember Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, David, when he was asked to judge in a dispute between two parties. He listened to one, he did not listen to other, and he gave his ruling. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blamed him for that action. That you need to listen to both. No matter how good is the testimony of that party, you still need to listen to the other in order to give a fair and a just judgment. What was the reaction of Dawood? فَاسْتَغْفَرَ رَبَّهُ وَخَرَّ رَاكِعًا وَأَنَا. Ask for forgiveness and bowed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So bowing, ruku' and prayer symbolizes our ability to transcend our own weaknesses, to transcend our own errors. And here it makes a lot of sense that they were asked to pray, to spend in order to be transformed, zakah. Even in Arabic we say az-ziyada fil khayr, you be transformed to increase your level or to elevate yourself into higher levels of goodness. This is zakah, and this is how sharing transform the human being, make you a better human being. So ruku' will help you to make that transformation because you are transcending a previous one. Again, ruku' or repentance should not only be limited to errors. Even when you are doing something good, don't become enslaved in that level. Don't be imprisoned at that level. You need always to liberate yourself to move into a higher level. So repentance also should be looked at and viewed in a positive way. Not only to weep out previous errors, which is still embedded in the meaning of repentance, but really we need to share with our friends, with our with the people around us, that repentance should also have the positive also aspect of it. To continue moving, to liberate us from the yesterday. You see how close is yesterday to us? Let it alone all these years before the yesterday. Is there more liberating than this? To liberate yourself from your own weaknesses and from your own victories. Otherwise the journey will stop. You see, it's also always about how to keep us moving. Because we are moving where? Towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is absolute. Is that right? So the movement should not really stop.
And it is so beautiful what you are saying, that after the ruku, immediately we stand up and go to the sita. There's another repentance.
Yes.
Finally,
yes. In fact, if you make an error inside the prayer, you need a higher level. What do you do? You made sajda, not ruku'. It's a higher error and within the prayer. You need higher level to repent and restore the balance. What is an error? Disturbance of balance. Is that right? So you are restoring the balance when you repent. However, again, in the negative sense or in the positive sense, okay, you are restoring balance. Because people all the time think that the disturbance go in one direction. No, it can go into the other. That may look as if it is good, but if it goes too far, it goes also to the extreme, and it is not accepted. Again, we gave the example before. Bravery is the opposite of cowardice. Is that right? But if bravery goes in the other direction, too far, what it becomes? Recklessness. And the officer will give you a ticket for recklessness. Is that right? Driving recklessly. It is, the brave is not reckless. In fact, the brave is the most who really fear and calculate the risk. Is that right? So you can go and the same thing. Autonomy is the opposite of helplessness. But also autonomy, if it goes in that direction to the extreme, it becomes self-sufficiency. استغناء. And Quran said that استغناء is a state of transgression, of imbalance. كلا, you remember the first surah? كلا, إن الإنسان ليطغى طغيان. Transgression. أن رآه استغنى. استغناء. Self-sufficiency. Self-sufficiency or autonomy is not equivalent to self-sufficiency. You need to be autonomous, but you cannot work alone. You need your team to work with. So أقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة. They were doing these things, but now in a new form, with a new objective. وركعوا. You need to transform into the new era. And then Quran, this is where we were discussing earlier, said, أتأمرون الناس بالبر وتنسون أنفسكم وأنتم تتلون الكتاب أفلا تعقلون. Read for us, please, the translation.
The translation says, enjoin you al-bir, and in parenthesis they have put down the rightness, the righteousness and every act of obedience to Allah on the people, and you forget while you recite the scripture.
You forget what?
You forget to praise it, practice
yourself.
It.
Uh-huh.
Yourself. While uh-huh. you recite the scripture, and in parenthesis the Torah, have you then no sense? That's what it says.
So the point here is that, okay, if you really believe in what you are preaching to others, then you have to be the first to be implementing and applying what you are really preaching to the people. How come that you are enjoining righteousness and doing everything that is good to others, and you forget about yourself? What does it really mean? Really, Sister Asya, if I ask you, how one really forgets about himself or herself? How do you understand it? From what you have learned in your studies and in our discussions, what comes to mind?
For me, the first thing comes to mind is lack of consciousness again. You're
very
not
good.
Using, you're not using your think, you're just uh-huh. putting forward.
You are not using
your thinking.
Thinking, say it high. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. This is the idea. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. You are not using your thinking faculties. You are not reflecting on your actions. However, it is in the form of saying something or acting. Even saying is an action. Is that right? So there is this discrepancy, this disparity between action and reflection. And we said last time that these two have to happen simultaneously. You cannot separate reflection from action or action from reflection. You act and reflect, you reflect and act. Okay? So the moment you stop reflecting on your own actions, you are really dehumanizing yourself. You start to lose your self-esteem. Start to lose the power, your inner power. So you are not, so you use your integrity. You say something and you do something else, or you do not follow it. This is really the huge.
And
Quran is saying, وَأَنْتُمْ تَتْلُونَ الْكِتَابِ. You are reading the book, but you are not reflecting on it. Do you get now the answer? The answer for your question at the beginning. Can you accept reading تَتْلُونَ الْكِتَابِ without reflection? أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ? You see, where is the disparity that Quran is always warning us. This is a disease that can, that nobody is really like immune to it, but we need to be vigilant about it. I mean, have you seen somebody telling him or her that you have this diagnosis and they are happy about it? They are not happy. So this is really a disease that we need really like to protect ourselves all the time, not to fall into it or to be afflicted by it.
But what bothers me is yes. At that time when they were making their argument, said talking about false stories, you know, a grandfather and a grandson and this and that.
Myth, superstition.
Yeah, superstitious.
Yes.
It doesn't make any sense. I said it at that time. I said it doesn't make any sense. It's a false story. You know, and they make their argument that even if you do this, you will be cleansed, you will be clean, just by, you know, your mind, your brain, your everything.
The idea, I mean, Brother Yusuf is talking about, in reference to a discussion or that he witnessed, that talking about really just reading Quran, without really reflecting on it, is still okay. But that should not be the message.
Right. And just to add more to your talk, brother, like for critical thinking, if you are remembering, recalling, and are able to reproduce information that you read, you're using low order thinking skills. To infer, to predict, to synthesize, you're using high order thinking skills. At this point of time, if the kids are reading Quran at high school level and trying to understand the information given to them, they are using low order thinking skills, good for them. As an adult, we have to use high order thinking skills. We have to see, as brother said, I'm so impressed, mashallah, I'm so blessed to listen to him, that we need to understand the concept through contextual background information about society, culture, and political system, how it affected an individual. Mm-hmm. And in order to do that, we have to infer, predict, synthesize, use high order thinking skills that would make us do critical thinking and analytical thinking, and then that's the...
You said it really the best way. I cannot say it the way you said it. It's very beautiful. Don't you agree?
Yeah.
That really, I am, what bothered me, honestly, is that not that Brother Yusuf told me that story, but last week, Brother Shaquille told me a similar story.
Right.
And I was told by my wife a similar story, which means that this is like penetrating our communities. Okay,
making
that, is this more manipulation?
Right.
than to ask somebody to stop thinking, to stop reflecting? I mean, let me tell you, even in our professional life, we are asking people to reflect on what they are really doing. Then why in our spiritual life? We don't need also to stop and reflect? If we are reflecting on our actions to make sure that we understand why we are doing them, okay? I don't want to understand the reference of meaning and reflect on it. And Quran explicitly saying and putting it in a question, in a rhetorical question. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ It's a question mark.
Yeah.
But it doesn't need an answer from Quran. It should come from us saying, oh God, no, we need to reflect. Because on what we are reading from the book. So Quran in a way is saying, look, this problem occurred to people before you. Don't repeat it. This is where history repeats itself. It's not history, believe me. We are repeating the history. History is an abstract thing. But we are the people who are writing and making history. We are repeating it. You see, that is the problem. So what does it really mean when you are repeating? So you are in a circle, in a vicious circle. You are not moving upward. You see what I mean? This is like going in circles. This is when you go to a neighborhood and then you don't have your GPS and you're probably, I mean, like just relying on your memory, and what happened? You are lost. Even in a small neighborhood, you will be lost. Why? Because you will be going in circles. You are not progressing towards your destination. We don't want this. The interesting thing about Quran is its dynamicity. It's movement, it makes you move all the time from one level to the next. Tazkiyah, transformation. That should come from reflection, action and together. It is referred to as praxis, P-R-A-X-I-S, praxis. Please remember that term, very beautiful, because it includes both action and reflection. Okay? Reading is an action, but you need to reflect on what you are really reading. When you go to prayer, you are reciting all the time. Quran or prayer, dua or something like that. Quran is saying don't go to prayer if you are drunk. Why? Quran is saying حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُونَ So that you know what you are saying. So don't, Muslims in general do not drink. Is that right? But we are acting as a drunk. Quran doesn't, it's not talking about here about just liquor. Just as if one form to be drunk by liquor. But Quran is saying, don't behave as a drunk, saying something that you don't understand. And then you are telling me that we can read without reflection, without thinking. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُوا This is the reasoning. Behind not coming to prayer as a drunk, so that you know what you are really saying.
Where is that ayah in the Quran?
In Surah An-Nisa.
That's beautiful. I also, correct me if I'm wrong, the wording in the Quran are used, you know, they are so perfect. Here, like for example, Afala Taqilun. Taqilun came out from Aql.
Yeah.
Somebody can say, for example, God forbid, Afala Ta'alamun. But Allah did not use Afala Ta'alamun.
Yeah.
He used Afala Ta'alamun.
Exactly.
There is a meaning.
This is what the sister is saying. Yes. It's a higher faculty. It's a higher faculty. And that's what, again, what distinguishes us from other, our ability to think. And Sister Ashia put it nicely, because once you stop thinking, you lose your consciousness. You are not really acting consciously. It's not mean you lose consciousness, meaning that you are, God forbid, like in coma. No, no, it's like you are not aware of what that really means to you in your own life.
If you look at the brain, you're so right. Like when you're talking about simultaneous, the brain is just one unit.
Exactly.
But it is divided. And we can go into automatic and conscious.
Yes, you are right.
So the structure, like you said, if you look at the structure, the universe, the realm that created us, it's all there.
Very good.
And it's a matter of choice.
And exactly. Believe me, this is what I said in the last Friday khutbah, that this is how I started. The human consciousness is not automatic. It's volitional.
And the choice is the only
choice. It's volitional. You see, this is what makes us humans. This is why I say we are dehumanizing ourselves. We will be manipulated. We act as objects.
Animals. Reactive.
They still, I mean, like they know, they can, they have sensation, they have perception, and they act according to what they have. They are not to blame if they are not conscious about what they are doing, because they don't have that faculty. But we will be blamed.
And we call it the evolved evolution of the brain. They start with the reptilian brain and they go into it. So the humans have
exactly.
The
cortex. So then you see where you transcended. So there is something common we share with others, and then we distinguish ourselves from others. There is something that we share with other creatures, and then
no wonder where Allah is most beautiful, because we have everything He created. You have the angelic, you could be higher than the angel, you have the satanic.
Yes.
Could be less or more.
Exactly.
Your brain could be animal or human. Like, it's amazing. We're everything.
Yes. Yeah. And again, look at the model of the prayer.
Yeah, all the way.
Yeah, that's how it evolved. Mm-hmm. Okay, in a way, so we, over thousands of years, it took for the way we pray, okay, to be perfected, to include all these really stations and these states. So when you are moving, sometimes you see these rest areas to refuel, is that right? And we need also in our spiritual life to stop and reflect, to refuel our inner soul, okay, in order to continue really the journey. And this is how Quran addressed the Jews being people of the book. You are closer than others. You know what does it really mean. Revelation, prophecy, you are, and the address to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that this is a phenomenon. You are not the first prophet. ما كنت بدعا قل ما كنت بدعا من الرسل. I am not the first one to say I am a prophet and a messenger. And believe me, even big people are not really interested of being, to be affiliated with one religion versus another. Like Max Weber, who studied really the sociology of religion, he came to the conclusion that because this happened over and over again, through the history of humankind, he couldn't really ignore it or neglect it. He said, I have to believe because this is now a phenomenon. What does it mean, a phenomenon? Something that happened over and over again. And people say, oh, we have this phenomenon. And it is a universal phenomenon. He came to that conclusion and believe it is the same meaning, قُلْ مَا كُنْتُ بِدْعًا مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. This is how Muhammad ﷺ told his people, why are you belying me? Why are you saying that I am not a prophet? You have not heard about the previous people who were prophets? Yes, there are people who claim to be prophets, but immediately the reality basically proved them wrong. And people rejected them. Most of the time, at least. But others, they have common things and common message, and he couldn't neglect it, he couldn't ignore it. And this is why he studied it.
So what was his conclusion? What's a phenomenon? Religion itself?
That the prophecy, because you see, what happened in sciences today, however in natural or humanity, natural science or humanities, the moment you mention religion, prophecy, angels, or whatever, they tell you, no, this is not science. Don't talk about this. Weber made that revolution that you cannot ignore this because it is a phenomenon, because it repeated itself. Several people came with the certain message and they, yeah! You see what I mean? Across generations, time, place, person, okay? It's you cannot ignore it. And really one of his best observations, saying that rarely, prophecy emerges from priesthood. I am not against the priests. Don't misunderstand me. In fact, I really wanted today to take the opportunity and congratulate the new Pope, because he is a symbol of the advocate for poverty, advocate for the poor, not poverty, advocate for the poor, okay? We need to work together to eliminate this problem, once and for all. And this is a big opportunity to have someone in that position saying, I will not forget the poor. And he is not preaching something and doing something different.
That's exactly what I was searching through this comment that he some from the comments he made, but the surah, because if you look at the Catholic Church, it's the most rich institute in this whole world.
Yeah.
But it's practiced by one of the most poor people in the world too, mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
So that's like, they're not preaching, they're not practicing what they're preaching, right? So I think your point about the new Pope and what he's trying to say,
yeah,
is long overdue.
Overdue. Again, we are supposed to support,
right,
people of that caliber. Quran referred to them, يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْقِسْطِ مِنَ النَّاسِ. مِنَ النَّاسِ, people, regardless. Let it alone if someone in that very sensitive position. In the world, not like only in one country or one locale, but really in the world. So, again, you can see how important it is to recognize goodness, high values, okay? But if someone is behaving as a custodian on the religion, you see that this is the fear, that you behave as a custodian, that you start speaking
in authority of
the religion. you prevent people from thinking. You see, you start really impinging on their freedom, and no progress outside the freedom. There is no progress outside the freedom. The moment you monopolize anything, you stop progress. I was sharing yesterday with Sister Arshia, this celebrated English historian of the 18th century, Gibbon, G-I-B-B-O-N, especially for the young generation. He is really a, not only historian, who has really the grasp on the march of events, but he also a philosopher of history. And again, if you locate him in time and the place, he was a rupture, because everybody was concentrating on events. And he came to say, no, we need to start really approaching history differently. Towards the end of his life, he accumulated a huge library. And one of the lords in London, Sheffield, by the name Sheffield, he said, I will build for you in my palace library under your name, and I will call it Bibliotheca Gibbonima. It's really an honor, is that right? And he refused the offer. He said, my library is based on the relics of people before me that I had the ability to use. And I want my library. I don't believe in the monopoly of information, of knowledge. And I want it really to be distributed after me to the people. You see how this individual, what I see in his act, he is liberating himself from himself. It's not anymore for me. Like we saw with Newton, when he came to the discovery of the equation for gravity, what did he call it? The law of gravity. Did he call it the Newtonian law of gravity? He called it what? The universal law of gravity. He discovered it, but he liberated himself from it, so that it will belong to the people. A universal. I have so many things to differ with Marx, but he said one thing that everybody probably loves, when he said, I am not Marxist. Do you think that Isa alayhi salam said, I am Christian? He is the Christ. But he never said, I am Christian. Even Christian people say, not me. I read it. I did not came up with it. But it is very important, because you are for everybody. See when somebody tell you are a Muhammadan. No, I am not Muhammadan. The same thing. But we didn't know why we were revolting against it before. Now we understand why we revolt against this type of naming. You see where you Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is rahma lil alamin. He is a messenger. He is bringing. He is showing us the way to approach the truth. Not to follow him as a person. So we need, my dear brothers and sisters, to pay attention to the importance of birr and the importance of righteousness. Because today people are really misinterpreting things. And in the name of religion, they are destroying places that represent righteousness. I'm sure you have seen these YouTubes of people like destroying this maqam and this grave or this really place where people like remember important people through history. Instead of seeing these as rest areas, as stations to remind people of righteousness. When the last time you saw somebody making prostration to a grave? One. Yes, they go and visit that grave to remind them of how important are these righteous people. Not to, we pray to Kaaba, do we worship Kaaba? You go and touch it and kiss it. Is that right? Did anybody come and say that you are? But what it represents? It is the symbol of our unity. Is that right? So please, we have to stand up to all these wrong actions that are baseless. They lack understanding of what does it mean righteousness, what are the aspirations of the people, what are their hopes, what they have, what they believe in, how they are acting. This is nonsense. So these have been there for hundreds of years in our countries. Today you are telling the people that all these things are wrong and they have to be destroyed? For what? The beauty, the strength of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He appeared in a society that worship idols. So there is a high chance that they will worship him. Is that right? Did anybody worship Muhammad in his days? Or after him? When the last time you saw somebody worshiping Muhammad? You see that the strength? Why are you afraid then? If Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself was not worshipped, you are worried about people who are by far less than him to be worshipped?
Distraction.
You see how they are manipulating us and insulting us, insulting the people and their intelligence and their faith and their iman, believing in something higher. Did anybody of you read the story of Peter, the disciple of Isa alayhi salam? You are probably, most likely, from where did he come? From Palestine, what is known today as Palestine. He moved to Rome. Is that right? Peter, he is basically buried there. People go there to visit. Huh. Is that right? Peter,
yeah.
The most important, the rock. He was referred to as the rock by Jesus, peace be upon him. You think he took a flight from Palestine, from the Middle East to Rome? He was a fisherman. He probably used his small boat and the rest walking. And this is how I understand the washing of the feet of the disciples by Isa alayhi salam. This is my personal interpretation. That you are you are invited to a big mission. You need your feet. And they walked on these feet. And why people? He is an immigrant to Rome.
Yeah.
He's not from Rome or raised in Rome. Why do you think people made an abode for him? Till today, people will go and visit. And I will say it with huge confidence that, inshallah, if I have the chance to go and visit that place, I will go there and I will read Al-Fatiha without any reluctance. He is a disciple of Isa alayhi salam. But why, tell me, so sociologically, why the people will appreciate a person like this? They should have seen something. Birr! They saw righteousness. And they built that place to symbolize righteousness. People don't pray to Peter. They don't worship. Have you seen anybody worshiping Peter? I have not. Or Lord. But people, they like to celebrate and commemorate goodness.
You're also talking about basic human nature.
No question about it.
You need a role model.
Ah, very good. So this is why I call them, these are like rest areas. Every, you move, you are traveling and you pass. And you remember righteousness. You go and visit and you remember.
To
exactly the same way I want to refuel my car and I want to bring food to continue the journey, I need.
Get more strength.
Strength, yes. Internally. You see, I mean there is, I cannot understand it. Yes.
I think we do not condone any specific act of destruction or anything for the tombs of the older, righteous people and so on. But we cannot kind of ignore the idea that people still get confused that these tombs of righteous people make them lose the sight that these people cannot hurt or help. And that's where the confusion comes. And actually the equalization of
so Islamic, so how do you amend?
How I do is that you have to bring the lay person the idea that he is as good as Peter and he's able to be Peter and he's able to be that guy.
Very good. Too. Exactly.
But
they
not
are.
make him higher than
exactly.
Him saint that can make him
exactly.
To God.
So you need to educate, not to destroy.
That's right.
You see that the problem that we are like in the name of like believing in something, we take the wrong direction.
Yeah.
That is the problem. Do we need to educate people all the time? Yes, and I agree 100 times. I mean, with you that this is very important. But really, it's to move in this life only by fear that. Something may happen that you cannot move one step forward. You see, fear is not going to help us. It will obstruct us.
But conceptually speaking, at a certain point, even the Prophet, peace be upon him, symbolically destroyed the idols. Because people was, as the Quran says, they were talking about idols, not that they worshiped them, but they made them closer to God. And that's the same concept today. Even people are much worse than that. People will think today that these people not only make them closer to God, but they make stuff answer.
Believe me, who has done a survey? We won't really like to approach this issue in a scientific way. Who really did a survey asking the people why you go there? You see, I mean, I'm telling you that I think most of our actions are based on possibilities. But there is no, and the probability, and there is no really real way of approaching and studying these issues and to see. You see, remember we said at the beginning of the discussion that Quran is talking about the importance of having in the society this group of muttaqin who are monitoring what is happening in the society. How do you monitor? You do
sometimes studies. You do surveys, you have a questionnaire, and then you say, oh my God, there is a problem here. How then I need to approach it? But I do not solve the problem by destroying. The idea of the idols was very clear that people were worshipping them. And the people themselves who were worshipping destroyed them because now they understand. Okay, but they did not destroy Kaaba because the meaning associated with Kaaba was different from the meaning associated with the idols. You see what I mean? So that is really also a very important difference. Yes?
I just wanted to clarify what I think Ashok was saying about the confusion within the Catholicism when people begin to worship the saints. But coming from the perspective of someone who has converted from Catholicism, I can tell you that the saints, there are so many, there are saints from everything from housekeeping to pancreatic cancer, I mean, everything. And people also believe in the Catholic faith that when they're, even when their grandparents die, if they lived good lives that were worthy of emulation, that they become like saints. So for Catholics, they believe if they pray to these saints that they can intercede on their behalf to God. And I think that's where Ashok is having the need to clarify that when people go to St. Peter's tomb, for what reason? And some Catholics do become confused and begin to worship the saints instead of seeing them as an example of how to live their lives. And I think that was the point that he was making.
But yeah. And I don't disagree that this is a
potential
problem.
But still,
it has to be approached through education.
And historically for people to
exactly
see how people live to know how to live their lives.
Because really one of the most important method to transform the human being is really how to remind the human being of his and her autonomy and that they are capable of doing and solving their problems on their own and getting the help of others, but not by really like putting the onus on somebody else. And this is another form of forgetting ourselves. وَتَنْسَوْنَا أَنفُسَكُمْ. No, we don't want to forget about ourselves, but we want to empower ourselves that we can be like these people. Leaders of righteousness, models for righteousness. Okay, so they need to like encourage us, incite us to do more. If that happened before, it can happen also now. That is really the most important thing. And this is a struggle. This is a struggle in every aspect. Because, and this is why the next verse is saying, "Wasta'inu bis-sabri was-salah." You need patience because, and this is a struggle. And when you are really facing a difficult situation, resort to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through prayer. So let the prayer, as Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, that if he himself was facing a difficult situation, he will resort to prayer. What does that really mean? That I have tried everything. That I really need more empowerment. I need to connect with the one who has the power and the knowledge and the justice and all these attributes. And who has also the attribute of sabr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described himself as sabur. One of his names is as-sabur. That he is the most patient. Okay? So, prayer becomes a very important fountain to tap patience. Because the more, if you move, you will be facing difficult situation. If you don't move, if you stay at home, nothing will happen. Okay? So you don't need patience. But if you are really moving, and we are supposed all the time to move, okay? To continue the journey, not the journey will not be pleasant all the time. There will be situations, there will be adversities that are really of situations of difficulty. And so we need patience and we need the connection with the one who is more powerful than us in order really to continue. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always with the people who are really patient. And patience is very connected with time, which is very important element, okay, and how to approach things. Many times we need time to see the change. Sometimes you need to wait before you intervene. Okay, so this is a very important healing attribute that we really need to tap into it all the time.
I think the people who are looking up to those, they are symbolizing something. I think they have a need inside them.
Mm-hmm.
So people who go to those side ziyarat, I think that's what we heard,
mm-hmm.
do
mm-hmm.
go do that.
To visit, yeah.
They're asking for something. They're looking for something. They're looking for guidance. So they're confused. I think that's the thing. Like they don't know. Like this is to help. Maybe the place they're going to, they're asking for something. If they stop there, that's it. That's incorrect. But if they need to say this is that's the way for me to empower myself, understand what problem I'm facing, I need to ask other people for help too, not just this one symbol. You know, that's one, you know, grave side that they're going to. They're thinking that they're using that as a medium
exactly.
to get closer to Allah.
Exactly.
But we have other
you are right, because
means to get closer to
that
Allah.
Is really the situation,
mm-hmm.
okay? It means that my journey has stopped.
Stop, right.
Okay, I don't want to move anymore. Let somebody else do things for me. Okay,
exactly.
Which is really against what we have been talking about. Okay. But again, the message from this discussion is we cannot solve these problems by destruction.
No.
Okay. We really need to educate the people because still there is something that people can make out of this. Okay. So that people will know that there is value for righteousness. Okay. And we need to value. Right, we need to believe in righteousness. Even today, in our own professional life, they tell you if you don't believe in something, you will not do it. You see what I mean? So you need to believe that there is something higher. صَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَ You have to believe that there is something better to aspire for it, and so you act to move and transform yourself. And move it into the next level.
Also, just visiting them is not the end of it. You know, you go there, you visit with them, great. But you reflect on their lives,
exactly.
what they have done, what kind
exactly.
of rightness
yes.
they have, what kind of patience they had. Like you will give
yeah.
the example of Peter.
Yeah.
He walked from. He must have walked.
Yes.
Not in an airplane. What kind of difficulties and everything he had. But he had a mission,
yes.
and he carried that mission. And
that he believed
in. And he believed
yes.
in.
Yeah.
You know, those are the kind of things we should reflect in our life. In the Quran, Allah, I think, is giving an example of a donkey, that don't be like a donkey
yes.
having books on your...
Very good. This is another...
Right.
مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاةَ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا كَمَثَلِ الْحِبَارِ يَحْمِلُوا أَسْفَارًا So if you have the book, even if it is... The highest and the noblest of books, like the Torah or the Gospel or Quran, okay, if you are carrying it and you are not really benefiting from it,
it's just like
Quran is saying, as it, like the donkey carrying books. Mm-hmm. The donkey is not understanding what is happening. This is really big.
It's really big.
I mean, I put it in the language of Quran. Quran is very, very like conscious about using anything that is like demeaning or something like that. But when the situation is really big like that, Quran uses this just to alert the people. So if you put it in context, this is a big, as if it is a big crime to have the book and not reflecting on it. Yes.
I like what you said about that, and I was reading something about people who live holy lives, like an avatar, in relation to the energy. So if somebody, even if they don't teach anyone else, even if they just live their lives in a way that is holy and reflective and intentional, they leave the tracks for people behind them to do the same.
Yeah, okay, which means that this is what Quran refers to as uswa. أسوة. لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة. So being a model, okay? These people, as you are saying, sometimes you don't have to say anything. Through their actions, inspire the people around them. Okay? Yeah. And أسوة here. This terminology, this Quranic terminology, it does not mean mimicking. But you come to agreement with the person that you see before you. Oh, I agree with what your action and the rationale and the objective of your action. This is why I will do it. You see what like what we learn, okay, in medicine to do this procedure or that, and we follow others. But you see that unless you really understand it and you agree with that, and this is why I tell my patients, I said, believe before I give you the antibiotic, I have to believe in it. If I don't believe in it, why I have, yes, so many people have given that antibiotic and I'm doing the same thing, but it is not mimicking. Because at one time, if I don't reflect, that same antibiotic may kill the patient. If the patient happened to be allergic to that medicine. Is that right? So you see, uswa is not mimicking. But somebody is showing the way and you agree with that. So you are still using your thinking. You are became conscious. And this is what I want to come up from this, that these people, these good people, righteous people, that people want to value, they want to value. That is the whole idea, to make others conscious about their righteousness. And they become the model for others really to emulate.
Well, all of what was in education. If they're in the school system, they don't show them role model people with other kids for the study, they never gonna see. They're gonna see that on video.
Yeah.
Because there's no end of role model born in the generation for the around here in our society.
Mm.
They don't have
yeah.
anything. It's
yeah.
all show business.
Exactly. And I think I'm happy that you brought this and because many times, like we know about people who did really good things in life, and we really like to learn and understand what they have done, but we are still like doing it in a very traditional way, repeating what is there. You see, instead of saying how should I present that personality in this age and time? You see what I mean? So people have written about these good peoples in different ways. But I have to ask myself today, and I think that's the idea behind like in the regular school, they ask the students and to do projects about certain personalities, previous presidents, scholars, scientists, okay?
But here comes really the strength, okay, and the beauty of how you can really present these people in this time, and which means really needs deeper understanding of these three personalities, rather than repeating the same thing what has been written in the history books. It may, you may take the same story and they say, how should I produce it again?
Use a different language.
Oh, I mean, this is the beauty today of the one these the lot of sciences have to come together in order really like to make like a movie about one. I have not seen yet the movie Lincoln, but I'm sure that it was presented in a different way. Although it is based on a book or something like somebody has written the biography of this president, but no question that who the producer had something in mind. What to highlight? You see what I mean? So I think that's what we need to learn, okay, and encourage the younger generation to use the current technologies, the sciences that are available to them to help themselves and help us to understand these important personalities really in history.
One more thing.
Yes.
What I learned from this, as we recited and tried to understand the meaning of it, وَآمِنُوا بِمَا أَنزَلْتَ مُصَدِّقَ. The way you said it, Quran is endorsing the previous revelations and then including them with this at the higher level. And it is such a convincing argument. Allah could have said, no, stop what you are doing, that's it. This is the revelation and start doing this. No. Quran is endorsing those other previous revelations into this and taking it to the higher level. I think it's a very convincing idea.
It's very beautiful, and this is a methodology. In fact, we try to call it this way, the methodology of tasdiq and hayma, endorsement, and then going into the higher level of overarching. We gave the example in sciences how Einstein will not negate what Newton did, but will bring Newtonian physics into a higher level of understanding. Because even today, you can send a satellite to the outside space using the Newtonian physics. So it is not like meaningless. No. But if you want to apply Newtonian physics to the subatomic domain, it will not work. So it's not capable of answering all the questions. So you need to bring the understanding of the universe through the science of physics into a higher level of understanding. It will include Newton, but at a higher level of understanding. And this is how, this is a good analogy of how we need to understand Quran without really negating the revelations that came before. But it will be included. And we saw it even in the model of prayer. Quran is not saying that you are not praying. Okay? But the prayer I am asking you to follow has a different form that is more consistent with the challenges of the day, of this new era. You have entered a new era, and you need to be compatible. Your answers have to be compatible with the challenges of that era.
You had given two khutbahs. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to attend. One was about prayer, what it means, and what should we think about it, and also, I think, Hajj. Will it be possible that in one of the discussions we just talked about, though,
yeah,
you can repeat because
yes.
I don't know who or how many.
No, I mean I think that theme we will have. I mean, we can also think about doing like a workshop where we can
discuss really the different stations and what they symbolize and how we can connect them into our own daily life, then the prayer becomes a model for our cultural and social development.
Yes, let's do
that. Let us do that.
Your book is
very powerful.
Yes?
Your book is circular.
I mean, because we are covering that part.
The basic class of life.
Yeah. Shalom. Let us start really thinking about that, and we'll talk with the administration here and arrange for something like that. Very good. Okay. Thank you. JazakAllah.